Romans chapter 9, verses 14 through 18, which is somewhat of a continuation of the passage we preached 3 weeks ago in verses 6 through 13. And if you remember back 3 weeks ago, verses 6 through 13 is labeled by many scholars as the most difficult passage in all of Scripture to understand. It is the most difficult passage of Scripture for us to be able to grasp and kind of wrap our minds around, and that it details the sovereignty of God in the election process of calling people to salvation. That's hard for Baptists especially to understand. This is what I understand on this as we dig into this part of the Word of God. The very moment we think that we have God figured out, the very moment we think we've got God put right here in our hands and we know exactly who He is and what He is, God's going to turn around and remind us who He is. Greater, bigger, stronger, mightier than anything our minds can conceive. We'll never be able to put God inside of a box. This is what I'm reminded in my own life. I don't need to understand all of who God is. I need to trust who God is. I need to have my faith and my trust put behind my Savior to know that He is God and that His ways are good. So I want us to back that mindset this morning as we dig into this passage. Again, this is a continuation in the election process of God calling people to salvation. But church, there's such good truth inside this passage. Let's read it this morning. Romans chapter 9. Let's pick up in verse 14. I'm excited to dig in this today. Look what Paul says in verse 14. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Certainly not. For He says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So then it's not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but it's of God who shows mercy. For the Scripture says to the Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all of the earth. I want to remind you this morning, that is God's ultimate purpose. That is God's ultimate desire, even through us as a church this morning, that His name be declared in all the earth, that His power be seen, that He is God, and that He is God alone. Amen? I love that He speaks that truth. Scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose, I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Therefore, He has mercy on whom He wills, and on whom He wills, He hardens. Again, speaking on the sovereignty of God in the election process of salvation. Let's pray. Father God, as we open Your Word this morning, God, I pray that You would empty me out in my flesh. God, I pray in Jesus' name that You'd fill me in Your Spirit's power. God, give me a liberty of speech, a clarity of mind as I dig into Your Word. God, give us Your people hearing ears, God, to see how this applies back into our lives. So much application, so much truth for us to grasp on how much You love us and how You move inside of our lives and around us every day. So God, give us hearing ears today, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, inside this letter to the Roman church there, we see where Paul's literally anticipating questions that the Jewish leaders of that day, so to speak, are most definitely going to ask as he's writing this letter to the church. He knows as he's writing this letter. He already knows in advance. He knows that these people that are so religious are going to have questions about these truths that he's writing. So he's trying to anticipate those questions. And as a good leader, he's trying to answer those questions before they're even asked. And here's the first question that he's asking, if you don't mind. Here's his first answer. Anticipation. I'll put this on the screen for you. How can God choose some people and not others to receive His spiritual blessings? What kind of God does that make Him? And if He's choosing some people and not others to receive His blessing, is that not unfair of God? And it's funny, as Paul turns around and he asks this question, he doesn't even answer his own question. Better yet, he turns around and says, let me tell you about the greatness of my God. Let me tell you about the sovereignty of my God. How great He is reminds us we have no right to question Him. We have no right to come in and put our thoughts behind us and say, God, that's not fair. We have no right, no authority in that this morning when we truly understand how great and how mighty our God truly is. God is God, and church, we are not. I want us to stop and say that together this morning, because I want to make sure that we have that truth inside of our minds. God is God, and we are not. Do you believe that today? Because we have a tendency sometimes of trying to elevate ourselves to that position. Do we not? When circumstances arise, we want to play the role of God. We want to play God inside of our own lives. We need to be reminded, first off, that God is God and that we are not. We simply need to understand that we need to surrender to his authority. And we need to surrender to his lordship. In Romans chapter 11, verse 33, Paul says this, "Oh, the depth and the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of our God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and his ways are past finding out." Church, can I tell you why we're not God? We're not as great. We're not as mighty. We're not in control. We're not sovereign as our great God is. Our God is so great and so mighty, church, we cannot understand all that he does, and that's okay, because I don't want a God that small. I want a God that's greater than my understanding. So this morning, as we dig into the second part of God's election, I want us to look at it step by step, understanding how this applies back into our life. So if you're taking notes, I want you to look at number one. We're giving a description of who God is. Number one, doubting God's righteousness. Note that, church, doubting God's righteousness. We need to be careful in doing that inside of our own lives, because in truth, church, we all do it day after day after day after day. We doubt God's righteousness. Instances, circumstances, moments that come up in our lives that leave us asking, why? God, why did you allow that to happen to me? You know who I am. You know that I love you. You know that I study your word. You know that I worship you. I'm yours. So God, why did you allow that to happen to me? God, what's your purpose in allowing that circumstance to step into my life? How are you wanting to use that? God, why would you do that? Have you ever asked that question before? If we're honest, we all have. Just be honest for a second, because that's exactly what Paul's asking in this question here in verse 14. He says this, "What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Is God," here's the question, "ever unfair in his ways?" Is God unfair in allowing that health circumstance in your life, in your family? Is God fair in allowing that financial situation to step inside your life? Is God fair when he allows that relationship to completely fall apart, when he or she walks away and it leaves you asking God why? Church, is God unfair when he does that? Paul says no. Look what he says there in verse 14. Is there unrighteousness with God? Certainly not. Is God ever unfair? He says no. No, no, church. In truth, we're simply called to stand in faith, believing and knowing that God is good and he will do what is right because he is righteous. God will do what is right because he's righteous. That's what God said of Abraham. Look at the moment when he was about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah there in Genesis chapter 18. I put this on the screen. You don't have to turn there. Genesis chapter 18 and verse 25. God's fixing to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and we know that account. Sodom and Gomorrah was a very sinful city, much more sinful than we would actually think we are today. Look what he says of them. "Far be it from you," Abraham speaking to God, "far be it from you to do such a thing," listen to this, "as to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous be as the wicked are." He says, "Far be it from you, God. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is right?" Church, I want to promise you this morning, because God is good, he will always do what is right. I want to remind you that inside your life. Because he is righteous, he will always do what is right, even if we don't understand. And I'll promise you this, most of the times we're not going to understand. We're going to be left behind shaking our heads. We're going to be left behind saying, "God, I don't get this. Why?" But we need to have that predetermined mindset, that predetermined confirmation inside of our lives, that even when we don't understand, we acknowledge that God is good. That's what sets us apart as people of faith, by the way. Not looking at the circumstance itself, but believing in advance that no matter what comes, no matter what steps in my life, God's still good. Whether it's to my advantage or my disadvantage, God is still good. So to answer that question, is God ever unfair? The answer is no. Church, it's an emphatic no, as Paul says. Why? Because God is righteous, because he is faithful, and because he is true. How do we know that? His word tells us so. I read it in the Word of God every day in my personal quiet time. He was reminding me over and over and over again, he is faithful and he is true. And guess what? It's not just in his word. As I walk through those circumstances in my life and I walk through those situations, God continues to confirm that as he stands by my side every single time. He shows himself faithful and he shows himself true. So church, we can stand beside Paul in that first point, declaring that God is righteous, that God is faithful, and God is true. Now I want us to look at number two. Number two, this is defending God's righteousness. This is Paul's defense. I gave my defense. I know that God is righteous and true because his word tells me so, and it's seen inside my life. Now Paul's going to give his defense on why he says God is righteous. He's actually seen here in verse 15, 16, and 17, and he looks at it from two angles. I'm excited about this. He looks at God's righteousness from two angles, and first angle is this. God is righteous when he exercises his mercy. There's great truth in our lives inside of this one. God is righteous when he exercises his mercy. And he points back to an Old Testament passage, actually the book of Exodus chapter 32, where God is guiding Moses along this journey as he's taking the people of Israel out of Egypt. We know this account, do we not? We know this story. God has called the people of Israel who have been in bondage, have been enslaved for 400 plus years. And God's calling them out of Egypt. And Moses is leading them on this process as they're coming out. And as they're on a journey going to the promised land, God calls Moses to the top of Mount Sinai where he's going to receive the Ten Commandments. God is literally going to speak to Moses face to face. What a moment that must have been. For 40 days and 40 nights, Moses is on top of Mount Sinai receiving the word of God. Who remembers what the people of Israel were doing about down below the whole time? Here we are, God's faithful, God's chosen people, right? God's called Moses to the top to receive the commandments on how they're to live, and the people of Israel down below telling Aaron, we don't know what's happened to this man Moses. Why don't you make an image for us that we can bow down to and worship? So they bring this gold together, and Aaron hammers out this image of a bull, a cow, so to speak, and they begin to bow down, they begin to worship this calf made of gold. How did God respond to that? Look in this. Church, Exodus chapter 32, verse 10, I put it on the screen. God said to Moses, now therefore leave me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against these people, Israel, that I might consume them, for I will make you a great nation. Church, God's fixing to annihilate the Israelites. He's fixing to absolutely destroy them for their sin. All this time, God's shown his power through them as he's delivered from this time of captivity. He's shown that he is truly God. He's walking them out, and how do they respond? They begin to bow down to a golden image. God shows himself inside of our lives over and over again. He shows himself to be faithful and true, and what do? We begin to prostitute ourselves back out to the things of the flesh. We're no different. We're no greater than they are. But here they are, church, and God's saying, hey, Moses, move out of the way. I'm fixing to absolutely destroy them. But let me ask you this. Did God destroy them? No, because if you dig on down there in Exodus 32 and verses 11 through 14, you see where Moses, the man of God, actually stands before God and says, God, are you really going to wipe them out? Are you going to make it to where the whole world sees that you actually couldn't carry them into the promised land that you gave to them? Are you going to show this to be true? And God actually relents. God, in the midst of his compassion, God, in the midst of his mercy, relents and does not destroy them. Look at what he actually says in verse 15, Romans chapter 9. For God says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. Again, Israel did not deserve God's mercy. They fully deserved God's wrath. But because of God's mercy, he relented and he had compassion. Can I give some application there, church, this morning for us? I fully deserve God's wrath this morning. You fully deserve God's wrath this morning. We, as a people, as creation itself, are a fallen people. We're a sinful people. And the Word of God tells us sin is worthy of God's wrath. We are worthy of God's full payment against us this morning. But because of grace and because of mercy, church, he extends love. He extends compassion inside of our lives, that which we do not deserve. Look what he says on in verse 16. It's not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but it's of God who shows mercy. Again, God's reminding us it's nothing of who we are. There's nothing that we can look down and God say, oh, but look at this one over here, or look at that one over there. This one's a really good one, God. That's why we should extend mercy. No, churches, he looks out upon creation itself. Each and every one of us, we're all fully worthy of God's wrath. But because of his mercy, he extends compassion to us and he offers us forgiveness, the gift of his son, Jesus Christ. Church, that's the greatness and that's the love of our God this morning. That's to prove, as Paul said here in point number one, angle number one, God is righteous when he demonstrates his mercy on us every single day. Amen? He is righteous. I'm thankful for God's mercy this morning because I know what I deserved. Church, do you? What a reminder for us today. Let's look at the second angle. And that is that also God is righteous when he extends his judgment. God is righteous, and we're thankful this morning when he extends his mercy because we are recipients of that mercy today. But I want to remind us also, God is righteous when he extends his judgment. Again, Paul's referring back to the Old Testament here, using the Pharaoh of Egypt as his example, giving a direct quote from Exodus chapter 9. So understand this. Romans chapter 9, verse 17, and Exodus chapter 9, verse 16 are identical verses. All Paul's doing here is giving a direct quote back from the Old Testament. And this is what he said. God said this to Pharaoh. For this very purpose, I have raised you up. For this very purpose, God has raised Pharaoh up. He said that I might show my power in you and that my name may be declared in all of the earth. Church, from that one verse, we have had an ongoing question for generations. Scholars have been asking this question for years and years and years. And I put it on the screen. Listen to this. Does God harden someone's heart and then punish them because of what they could not do as a result of God's hardening of their heart? I want you to look at that question. It's on a screen because we need to make sure that we have a correct answer to that question. Otherwise, we are going to have a warped view of who our God is. So I'm going to ask it again. Does God harden the heart of anyone? Think about this. Does God harden someone's heart and then punish them because of what they could not do as a result of God's hardening of their heart? Listen to me. No. No, he does not. Listen to this answer. God does not harden the heart of anyone who has not already first hardened their own heart against God. I'm going to show this in Pharaoh. God does not harden the heart of anyone who has not already first hardened their own heart. Yes, God did harden Pharaoh's heart after Pharaoh hardened his own heart against the call of God. I want to show this to you if you don't mind. It's not going to be on the screen, but I want you to listen as I walk through this. I'm going to pick up in Exodus chapter 7. I'm going to pick up in verse 1. The Lord said to Moses, "See, I have made you as God to Pharaoh, and Aaron your brother shall be your prophet. You shall speak all that I command you, and Aaron your brother shall tell Pharaoh to send the children of Israel out of his land." We know this account. We know this story inside the Word of God. So at this point in time, you're fixing to hear where God's going to give a prophetic word. This is how great our God is. I want to remind you this morning. God already knows what's going to happen tomorrow. God already knows the next day after that. God knows the day that we'll take our very last breath. That's the sovereignty, the omniscience of our God, the all-knowing power of our God. He's fixing to give a prophetic word here in verse 3. He says, "And I will harden Pharaoh's heart." This is what I'm going to do in advance, he says. Why? "I'll harden Pharaoh's heart, and I'll multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. But Pharaoh will not heed you." He's telling, this is my word, and I know what Pharaoh's going to do. Why? "So that I may put my hand on Egypt and bring my armies and my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great judgments. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand on Egypt and bring out the children of Israel from among them." Then Moses and Aaron did so just as the Lord commanded them to do. Church, Pharaoh himself is going to harden his own heart. I want you to watch as this takes place. God never touched him. Pharaoh does this on his own. I'm going to pick up in verse 8. "Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, 'When Pharaoh speaks to you, saying, show a miracle for yourselves, you shall say to Aaron, take your rod and cast it before Pharaoh and let it become a serpent.' So Moses and Aaron went into Pharaoh, and they did so just as the Lord had commanded. And Aaron cast down his rod before Pharaoh and before his servants, and it became a serpent." Church, did that really take place? The Word of God says so. Yes. I want to remind you that. This is not a story. This is not just an illustration that God uses. This is what literally took place to demonstrate and to show the power of our God. Verse 11, "But Pharaoh also called the wise men and the sorcerers. So the magicians of Egypt, they also did in like manner with their enchantments. For every man threw down his rod, and they became serpents. But Aaron's rod swallowed up their rods." Aaron's rod swallowed up their rods. Now listen to verse 13. "And Pharaoh's heart grew hard. And he," little h, "Pharaoh did not heed them as the Lord had said." There's that prophetic word, the word that God already gave back at the beginning. "And so the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh's heart is hard. And he," little h, "refuses to let the people go." So Pharaoh is hardening his own heart. God has not touched him in any way. God has hardened, Pharaoh has hardened his own heart against the call of God. Now I want us to drop down here. I want us to see this. I'm going to go section by section. I want you to see the plagues of God. I'm going to give the first six, if you don't mind, in short instance, to show you how many times Pharaoh himself hardens his own heart against God, and God gives him patience and the fact that he gives him an opportunity to turn back, and he never does. Listen to this. The first plague is the plague of water being turned to blood in Exodus chapter 7. And after that plague was performed, in verse 23 of Exodus chapter 7, it says that Pharaoh turned and went into his house, and his heart was not moved. His heart stayed hard of his own account. The second plague, the plague of frogs itself in Exodus chapter 8. After God sent these frogs into Egypt and it overtook them, he turned around and relented, because Moses interceded for them. And in verse 15, it tells us, but Pharaoh saw that there was relief. Little H, you ready? He hardened his heart. Pharaoh is hardening his own heart here, and he did not heed them as the Lord had said. There's God's word being fulfilled again. Pharaoh is hardening his own heart against the call of God. The third plague, the plague of lice in Exodus chapter 8. God sends lice into the people of Egypt, and it overtakes them completely. And then God relents as Moses intercedes. In verse 19, it says, but Pharaoh's heart grew hard, and he himself did not heed them, just as the Lord had said would happen. The fourth plague, the plague of flies in Exodus chapter 8. God sent the flies in, and then God relented after Moses interceded. In verse 32, it says, but Pharaoh hardened his own heart at this time also. Neither would he let the people go. The fifth plague of diseased livestock in Exodus chapter 9. God sent this disease in, then he relented as Moses interceded. In verse 9, but the heart of Pharaoh became hard, and again he did not let the people go. Five times, over and over and over again, God's given Moses the opportunity to go in before Pharaoh and say, here's who I am, here's what I've done. And Pharaoh continues to harden his heart against God time and time and time again. And it's not until the sixth plague enters, church, in Exodus chapter 9, as God sends the plague of boils upon the people. In verse 12, it says, but the Lord God then hardened the heart of Pharaoh. Five times God gave Pharaoh the opportunity to step in and to let go. And five times Pharaoh hardened his heart against God. I want to remind you, God did not move against Pharaoh until Pharaoh himself hardened his heart against God. I want to remind you that same truth applies to you and I today. God's hardening of anyone's heart will always be a response to the sinfulness of every person. Here's what I want us to grasp. God uses our sinfulness. Here's the greatness, the sovereignty, the power of our God that Paul really wants us to grasp this morning. God uses our sinfulness, mankind's sinfulness, for his purpose. God uses our failures for his glory, for his namesake to be lifted up. That's the power and the truth of our God, that he continues to move in ways far beyond our understanding. He takes our insecurities, he takes our failures, church, and he lifts us up before him every single time. God can take even our failures and be used for his glory. Number three, here's where I want to close out this morning. Number three, a declaration of God's righteousness. I want to give us a literal declaration of God's righteousness here this morning. This is a summation, if you will, in verse 18. He says, therefore, in summation, God has mercy on whom he wills, and on whom he will, he hardens. I'm going to say it again. Therefore, he has mercy on whom he wills, and on whom he wills, he hardens. This is what I want us to understand this morning, what we spoke to ourselves just a little bit ago. God is God, and we are not. We as a people need to learn to take ourselves off of that throne inside of our own lives and allow God to be Lord inside of our lives. We need to allow God to lead us as he chooses to. That he is God, he has to answer to no one. Church, in declaring God's righteousness, we have to accept the fact that he makes the calls. God moves in ways we may not understand, but he moves as he sees fit. Paul reminds us in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 5 that God acts according to his own good pleasure. In verse 5 he says, God predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself. According to how? To his own good pleasure of his will. God moves according to his own pleasure. In verse 11, it says he moves according to his own counsel. It says, in him, in Christ, we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purposes of him who works all things according to the counsel of his own will. Church, our God is sovereign. He declares his righteousness as he moves before us. The only question that he asked this morning is, do we have faith to trust him? And our Midas, it only takes the faith the size of a mustard seed. Do we declare God's righteousness inside of our lives as we submit, as we surrender underneath his lordship? If we truly call Jesus master and we truly call him Lord, church, we have to surrender. We have to trust him along the way. Let me ask this question. I'm going to step back and ask this question. Why doesn't God kill us immediately after we sin? What does Romans chapter 6, verse 23 say? The wages or the penalty of sin is what? Why doesn't God just completely destroy us and kill us after we sin? Church, God has a purpose, and he has a way of using even our greatest struggles for his glory. Instead of killing Pharaoh immediately, God hardened his heart to use him to demonstrate his power and his greatness before the Egyptians. God wants to use you this morning. He wants to use us this morning. He wants to use my life this morning. He wants to use our weaknesses. He even wants to use our failures if we'll just submit and surrender our lives before him. He wants to use every area of our lives to bring glory back to his name. He wants to use every area, every part of our lives to point back to his truth and the greatness of his salvation that he forgives. Church, that's the question I want to ask us this morning. Understanding that God desires none to perish, but all to come to everlasting life. And he chooses, for some reason that I don't understand, he chooses to use us as that instrument to declare it to this world. In my fallen state, in my weary state, God chooses to use me, and God chooses to use you. The question he asked this morning is, are we surrendered? Are we willing to lay down our lives that he could use us however he chooses and however he sees fit? Because here's what I want to remind you. If we don't lay down our lives, God's going to use us anyhow, as he did with Pharaoh. But it's going to be in a way that we don't desire. But when we lay down our lives, when we surrender and we trust God's plan to be greater than our own, we understand that he is master and he is Lord, and we lay down our lives, God will use us, watch this, and then he'll bless us for it. We don't deserve it, but God will bless us for it. But it comes back to obedience. Are we willing to surrender and lay down our lives? Have you ever surrendered and laid down your life before Almighty God? Allow him to lead you and allow him to use you. Church, with the greatest gift of all, and it's called salvation. Laying down one's life that he might pick it up and give you true life, life everlasting.